Good afternoon, everybody. This is Brother Lloyd. And to those who are keeping this Sabbath, as always, Shabbat Shalom. I hope you're having a blessed and peaceful Sabbath day. Now, before I get started, let me say this. A lot of you out there have someone, if it's not you, there's someone in your life that you consider they're making your life miserable. You're unhappy with them. There are all sorts of issues and problems going on with them, or vice versa. You may be that person. But bottom line is, the problem is that someone, you or them, aren't willing to submit to what the Father's offering. Everyone wants what he's offering, but people are unwilling to submit to that. And that means sacrificing or doing whatever he requires us to do to receive. See, we can't walk the line. We can't straddle the fence. We have to be on one side or the other. So anyway, I'm going to spend a few minutes talking about being broken. That's what we have to submit to. We have to be willing to be broken at whatever cost to receive what the Father is offering us. So with that being said, let's get started with brokenness. Okay, I have a few questions. Now, pay attention to these questions, because if they don't apply to you, but I think they all apply to you, me, and everyone else, but they may apply even more so to someone close to you, your husband, or your wife, or that child, or a family member, or whatever, that one area or that one individual that's creating chaos or grief in your life. This may even apply more so to them. But understand, it applies to you also. So do a self-evaluation as you listen to these questions. So the first one is, do you want the Father's best for you? Of course you do. We all do. No one would argue with that. But you have to go out and get it. See, that's the key, the requirements. Second question, do you want to become the person that he wants you to be? Of course you do. We all want to be the person that the Father desires us to be, because it assures us of so much. Third question, do you want to be able to accomplish and achieve the things that he has decided we should in our life? Of course, nobody has a problem with that. We all want to do that. Fourth question, are you willing to allow the Father to do whatever is necessary to bring you to a full surrender of all your abilities, your talents, your gifts, whatever, so that you can do these things that he has decided is best for you in your life? This is where people start going, whoa, whoa, whoa. And I'll tell you why. I'm going to give you a one-word answer, and that word is selfishness. One word. Selfishness. See, let me break it down like this a bit. Everyone wholeheartedly agreed to the last question. And if it's not you, but like I said, do a self-evaluation, it's someone else in your life, husband, wife, what have you. It really applies to them. They want all these things, but you get to that last question, people start balking, because now they start thinking about things stuff and all that. I get it. See, people are comfortable in their situations and they don't like the idea of changing, especially when it requires you to do things like maybe sacrifice or change your job or your position, that statue or that social standing that you have with everyone, your success as a athlete or entertainer or lawyer or doctor. See, people don't want to give these things up. Their financial security, all that money they have in savings, and their checking account, those retirement funds, or their house, their homes, their cars, their boats, etc. See, bottom line is that some of you are willing to let go of this kind of stuff to achieve and acquire what the Father wants us to have. This is what causes the problem. These are the things that we have to be willing to sacrifice. See, what the Father is offering us is a change in character and primarily eternal life. But the idea that everything that we own and have and possess may be one of the requirements to get that, people start really backing away. And now they start having a problem with the questions that I just asked. But check this out. Some of you, or those associated with you, whoever it applies to, but like I said, it applies to all of us, people are willing to sacrifice things like foul language that comes out of their mouth. Oh God, Lord, please help me stop with this foul mouth that I have. People want to pray that kind of stuff away. Certain attitudes that they have, like dislike for certain people, someone that they've had this contempt for so long, or someone that they just can't get along with. People want to get rid of that. They'll sacrifice that. Or racist or judgmental attitudes. Plenty of that going around. People are judgmental and prejudiced and racist and all these things. See, people who want to change and receive what the Father is offering, they'll want them to take that away from them. Or certain behaviors like smoking, drinking, bad dieting, causing you all these weight issues and stuff like that. People, they quickly want to give that stuff away. But in the meantime, people walk around speaking about God out loud to all those around them and presenting this pious attitude as if they're one of his newfound creatures, claiming how much they love him and always thanking him for all their success and all the things and everything that they've received and they have achieved in life. But in reality, they're only justifying it to men. Remember Luke 16:15, it reads like this. I read it last week. It says, "And he said unto them, Ye are they which justify yourselves before men, but God knoweth your hearts." See, he knows our heart. "For that which is highly esteemed among men is an abomination in the sight of God," or those things that are simply respected and admired by others. See, that's an abomination to him. So when you're going around willing to sacrifice what you want to sacrifice, but then on the other side you walk around going, "Oh God, this, God that, praise this, praise that," and you're not willing to really do what he requires of you to achieve what he wants to give you, you're just justifying yourself to men. You may be blessed with stuff, but by whom? See, you have to understand, people think they receive all these things and acquire all these things and they go, "Oh, thank you God," and this, that, and the other. Maybe, maybe not. But see, if you're working for the enemy, he may bless you also, especially when it comes to this worldly stuff. We have to be very careful, because sometimes in this blindness, people attribute all their success and all the things they receive and all this, that, and the other to the Father, while at the same time, they have a selfish heart, unwilling to sacrifice all these things if necessary, if it means receiving what the Father wants you to have and becoming who he wants you to be. People start balking and hemming and hawing about that, but yet they keep attributing all this stuff to the Father. Now, he may have blessed you with it, but rest assured, he will take it away. But then on the other side of the fence, you may be working for the enemy and really not realize it, because you may be one of those people who have and receive all this stuff, and you keep trampling on people and knocking people to the side and doing people wrong to maintain and hold on to this stuff. And then out the other side of your mouth, you're thanking the Father for it. You may be working for the enemy. See, you're living in a facade. You're living behind a wall that you perceive is something heavenly, and it's not really at all. Look, when it comes to the world and having stuff and things, people just aren't ready to give up stuff. They're looking for an easier way, but the Father's way is not easy, and it's not meant to be. It's not said to be easy. His is a path of sacrifice and serving, made difficult by who? It's made difficult by the world. The Father makes it easy if we give our heart, our mind, if we give it to him, and then we can rest in his peace and achieve and do what he wants us to do without suffering mentally and physically and stuff because we're caught up in the world. We won't care about that stuff, but we will appreciate and be grateful in any and everything that He blesses us with, but we'll always be willing to sacrifice that and give it up because we understand that it means very little when it comes to having what He wants us to have. Now, there are three points that I want to plant within you. That close association is the one primarily to be concerned with because you probably live with them, husband, wife, whatever, and it affects your household. So these are the people that we're primarily concerned with when we get into issues like this. So I'm going to elaborate on these three points and let that marinate and saturate your mind so that you understand who these individuals may be or something that they may be going through or what the problem may be if it's not you. See, because it can always be you. So here we go. Point number one. Go with me to John 12. John 12. And we're going to start with verse 20. And it reads, "And there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. The same came therefore to Philip, which was at Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and again Andrew and Philip tell Jesus. And Jesus answered them, saying," now pay attention, "The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit." Verse 25 reads, "He that loveth his life in this world," this is what he's talking about, "he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor." Now, like I pointed out in verse 25, it says that he that loveth his life in this world, that's what it's talking about. We have a reference, Mark 8:35. It reads, it says, "For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's," or the teachings of him and his life, "they the same shall save it." See, understand this. I'll break it down. We're like a corn of wheat. If we just fall to the ground, we eventually will dry up and wither away, not producing any fruit. See, this, and that's those of us who live and love our life in the world. We're like that corn of wheat and just falling to the ground and producing nothing. Eventually we're not surrendered to Him, and therefore we don't produce anything. So eventually we die and just wither away, having produced nothing. Now, those who are surrendered to Him or have died to self, that's what it's saying, they have died to self, they rise up, see, because they what? Become new creatures, and they produce much fruit. See, these are those who shall save their life or have eternal life. So you have to decide where you want to be. Do you want to be that corn of wheat that just lives in the world? You want to be that person that just lives in the world and get all the benefits of the world, and then you produce no fruit, you produce nothing righteous? Or do you want to sacrifice this life in the world and rise and become something new, a new creature, and produce much fruit? That's simply what it's saying. Now, the point, so to sum up point one is this: you can love the world and this stuff, live in the world and die in the world, having produced nothing. Or you can die to self for His name's sake and His teachings. You can produce fruit and you can have eternal life. Simply put, the word, like, I can't say it enough, the word is very simple when you study it, and we allow wisdom and knowledge to teach these things to us. Okay, point number two continues on with Luke 9:25, reading like this: "For what is a man advantaged if he gains the whole world and loses himself or be cast away?" And Psalms 49:6, 7, and 8 read like this: "They that trust in their wealth and boast themselves in the multitude of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his brother, nor give to God a ransom for him, for the redemption of their soul is precious and ceaseth forever. Now, let me go back to verse 6, because it says, they that trust in their wealth. We know plenty of people that trust in their own successes and wealth and things and all that. And there's a certain attitude and character that a lot of them have, that they're better than other people, or that they're well off and that they're doing fine and this and the other. But they're caught up in that world that provides all that. And they take these advantages and they gain and they gain and they gain, but they are lost. They are lost and caught up in this stuff. This is what I keep harping upon. People are so caught up in stuff and things of the world, and they're not willing to let it go, not willing to sacrifice to receive what the Father wants them to have, to do what the Father's will is for them. People want to hang on to this stuff as if it's going to get them into the kingdom, as if they can carry it with them, and they're going to die to this world with that stuff in this world. You have to be willing to let it go if he requires you to do that. Now, Mark 10:24 reads like this, speaking about people trusting in their wealth. Mark 10:24 reads, and his disciples were astonished at his words, but Jesus answereth again and saith unto them, children, how hard is it for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? See, just nailing down what I was just saying, you can't take this stuff with you, and the word says so. How hard is it for you to take those into the kingdom of God? It's not going to happen. That's the point. You may get all the advantages and things of the world, but at the price of losing yourself in it, getting caught up and lost in all that, is it really worth it? And then secondly, if you die in this mess, no one can redeem your soul. You die that way. It said forever. So is it worth holding on if it costs you everything, your eternal salvation, the main thing that we should be focused on? So now to point three, the final point. Luke 12:15, it reads, it says, and he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness. Beware of covetousness. Beware of being selfish and caught up and wanting and all that. For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possess. People, learn how to let this stuff go. It's fleeting at best. Psalm 62:10 reads like this, trust not in oppression and become not vain in robbery. If riches increase, set not your heart upon them. Don't get caught up in them. Don't change your attitude and your mind and everything and let that become your God. It says, set not your heart upon them. Don't put your mind upon that stuff. Appreciate it. Thank the Father. But always be willing to do what he wants you to do with it, not what you want to do with it. Because we aren't blessed with all this stuff to just hoard it and keep it for ourselves. He has a mission for us all, especially when we're blessed with an abundance. Psalms 52:7 reads like this, lo, this is the man that made not God his strength, but trusted in the abundance of his riches and strengthened himself in his wickedness. See, it's simple. The word is simple. So the bottom line is what? It's this. Some of you out there are caught up, or if it doesn't apply to you, you know someone that's caught up. Is it your husband? Is it your wife? And the bottom line to all that is, as long as we insist, as long as that person insists on having their way, there's always going to be chaos in their life, because that's what rules them. They're not focusing on the Father and doing what he wants. All the successes and pleasures of the world is their God. And we know who's running all that. But until you are truly ready to submit and willing to be broken at whatever price it takes, and that means every single area of our life, until you're willing to do all that, you will still not have what the Father desires for you to have. So the bottom line is, be willing and let him have at it, and let him change the course of your life. And with that, this is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.